truly appreciate the energy that you brought this afternoon. And for some more energy, it gives me great pleasure to invite to the podium a man who started this series and will continue it today. Join me in welcoming Deacon Derek Allwood. Let us welcome him as he comes.
Happy Sabbath to you all. Now, I remind you that I have some unfinished business to take care of. Let me first remind you of the title of the message. And this is part two. The Old Testament application in the New Testament. Now, last week we started out by showing you that Paul's letter to Timothy was about him expressing his views and his concern, and he said, you knew the scripture from earlier on, and we know that the scripture that Paul was talking about was the Old Testament. Of course, by this time, let me clarify something to you. By this time, there were no New Testament. But later on, one could claim that the New Testament was available some years back, because if you remember when Peter said Paul's letters are hard to understand. So, of course, we know that the New Testament were letters that was dealing with issues as it relates to the church. But certainly the scripture that they use by large is the Old Testament. We see where Jesus quoted from the Old Testament. And we also remember that Jesus said that he did not came to destroy the law and the prophet, but to fulfill them. And we know what that fulfilled mean. We also see where Paul, using the story of Abraham to illustrate and make and differentiate the Old Covenant from the New Covenant, when he spoke about Hagar and Sarah. So we want to continue, but there are many angles that I could come from, but I choose to use this handle that I'm about to give you. I remind you that most people are told that the Old Testament is no longer valid for us today, and we don't need the Old Testament. So Jesus came and he did away with the Old Testament. The Old Testament is not relevant anymore. Jesus said he did not come to do that. He did not come to do away with the law. But we want to look, if Jesus did not come to do away with the law, if the Old Testament is relevant for us today, then how can one preach Jesus? How can one preach the gospel from the Old Testament if it is not relevant? So I want to look at two sermons. This is a sermon within a sermon. How the apostles preach from the Old Testament. How did they teach Christ from the Old Testament? So let's look at the New Testament in the book of Acts. Because these are two very important sermons. From the initial stage, from the beginning. The book of Acts. Let's look at a couple of verses to see how Christ, to draw from their example, to show that the Old Testament is still relevant for us today. This is Peter preaching. On the day of Pentecost, when they were supposed to be in one accord, waiting for that special moment, the appointed time, the day they received the Holy Spirit. That's when the Holy Spirit inspired them to speak in other languages. Well, people, the Jews, the crowd, were saying, these guys are drunk. It's only the third hour in the morning. And Peter said, no, that's not true. Acts 2:16. Notice how we started speaking. But this is which. Now, we have always heard that Peter quoted Joel. But if you look further down the text, you would realize that Peter quoted more than Joel. And we're going to look at the relevancy of these texts and how these texts bring out what Peter was trying to bring. Spoke, he said, but this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And this was after Jesus was resurrected. He appeared to the apostles, opened their minds to the scripture. Because before now, they did not have full understanding of the scripture. Remember, they were on the road going somewhere. Jesus appeared to them. So now that they have this full understanding, everything is now open to them. The Spirit now is interacting with them through the words of the Old Testament. Concerning him in where? The law and the prophet and the psalm. That's how they start preaching. There was no New Testament. So today we are fortunate. We have the Old Testament. And we also have the New Testament, which brings more light. So we are very fortunate. So then he quotes Joel 6 in verse 17 and verse 19. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see vision, and your old men shall dream dreams, and even upon my servant and upon my handmaid will I pour out my spirit in those days. And they shall prophesy, and I will show wonders in the heavens above, signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. This was what took place. Now, what did take place during the death of Jesus Christ? This was a partial fulfillment of prophecy. He was on the cross. It was dark from the noon until 3 p.m. There was an earthquake. There were signs preceding this that is noted by a man called Josephus and other historian in the heavens. Signs in the heaven, verse 20. The sun shall be turned into darkness. That's what happened. The moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. This is not his first coming. This is referring to his second coming. So Joel is now talking about the second coming of Jesus Christ. So we see we can preach the coming of Jesus Christ from the Old Testament, as Peter did. Many of the prophecies of one or more fulfillment. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Then he started talking about Jesus, who was raised from the dead. He said, you have crucified. And remember, you know, Jesus was talking to the Jews. And I am almost certain that it would be more difficult to preach Christ from the Old Testament to a Jewish person, because we are assuming they are more familiar with the scripture. So for Peter and the other apostles to be preaching Jesus from the Old Testament, it's point to be noted. And he taught them those things. He also said that they were to be witness of what? He preached witness of his resurrection. So they would have questioned, because one who was the Messiah was going to be a descendant of David. And no wonder Matthew, who was writing directly to the Jews, had to make the point that Jesus, using the genealogy of Jesus to connect him back to David, he had to prove that this Jesus is is legitimate. His lineage was there for everyone to view. It was open record. It was nothing that was hid from them. Records were available for them to explore. But they did not. He was going to be a descendant of David. So they thought that God was going to raise David. And so Peter cleared that up in verse 25. For David speak concerning him, and for so the Lord before me continually. For he is at my right hand, and so I may not be moved. Therefore, my heart rejoiced, my tongue was glad, my flesh also shall rest in hope. Where is this quote coming from? Peter is quoting from Psalms. So he's not just quoting from Joel. He's now going to Psalms to establish the Messiah. So here now, he's preaching Christ from the Old Testament. Here is the direct quote. For you will not leave my soul. Those were the words of Jesus Christ. Quote from Psalms. Of course, you could say it was David, but it was a prophecy relating to Jesus. For you will not leave my soul. In the grave now will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You did make me to know the ways of life. You will fill me with joy, with your countenance. This is from Psalms. Who could believe that you could talk about Jesus in so much details? And I'm just starting from the Old Testament. So don't let anyone tell you that the Old Testament is not relevant. The Old Testament doesn't have it's just some good, great stories. It's just some story that tells you about the prophet. It's more than that. Because the gospel was preached from the Old Testament, as far back as Genesis. Oh, you think that Genesis was not a part of it? Let me speak to you freely concerning the patriarch David, that he's both dead and buried. So they probably thought that David would have been resurrected to establish the kingdom. And his tomb is with us to this day. Verse 30. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn to him in an oath that from the fruit of his loins, as concerning the flesh, he would raise up the Christ to sit upon the throne. David saw this and spoke concerning the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in the grave. Nor did any corruption. Here now we have 3,000 people, largely Jews, repented and baptized on that day. So Peter make the point. Of course, the Holy Spirit played a great role in all of that, because without the Holy Spirit to convince you, to open the mind, to remove the veil. And no wonder these people who claim that the Old Testament is not relevant, don't blame it on them. It's not their fault, because they are not being called. In Acts 3, very interested concerning what they did in raising the man who had been sick for so long, talking about Christ and his resurrection, Acts 3, 18 to 19. But what God had before announced by the mouth of all his prophets, that where they were preaching from, Christ, from the book, Christ would have suffered according to the scripture. Repent and be converted in order that your sin may be blotted out. Preaching repentance, not from the New Testament, but from the Old Testament. Then he says in Acts 3, 21, whom the heaven must indeed receive until the time, hear no part, until the time of restoration of all things. For who? Moses. So what we have here? We have the prophet. We have the Psalms, and we have Moses on the law right here in two chapters where they preach the gospel, teaching Christ from the law, from the prophet, from the Psalms. Acts 20, 22 and 23. For Moses truly said to the Father, a prophet, Moses, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up to you from among your brethren, like me, like Moses, because Jesus Christ was a type. Of course, Moses was the type, and Jesus the antitype. And if you look at the story, the narrative of the Exodus, it illustrates the salvation, the process of salvation. When Jesus Christ rescued us from our sin, God rescued the children of Israel from their sin. Type of Egypt, bringing them to the promised land, as Christ bring us to the kingdom of God. But before we reach the promised land, before we reach the promised land, it's not that simple. All of us must be tested. Must go through the wilderness. God said, I bring you through the wilderness so that I can test you and see what is in your heart. Now, let me pause a moment. The challenges that we face. I see from time to time people request prayer, meaning that they are not in the kingdom. Meaning that all of us have some issues, some challenges, whether it be health, financial. That is your wilderness. That is our wilderness. Our wilderness experience as the children of Israel go through the wilderness. Because Paul said these were written for us as an example. So unless we can look at the narrative, the stories in the Old Testament, and draw from the principles and apply it to ourselves, and then if we do that, if we know the reason, you see, if we know the reason why we are struggling, if we know the reason why we have all these issues and disappointment and pain and whatever, those who study for exam, those who are preparing for a career, going through denying yourself of the pleasures of going out, denying of yourself of hanging out with friends, to stay up late at night and study. It's not so hard because you know the reason why you are doing it. You can relate to it. You can relate what you are doing to the end result, what you aim to achieve. And so it is the same thing with us. It won't be as hard if we can associate our problem with the end result. Won't be easy, but I am certain that it won't be as hard as it is to you now. Because every time you can say, this is my wilderness, this is my experience, like the children of Israel, send it on, Lord. Because I want to reach a kingdom. Send it on. This is a test. You don't want the test? You don't want the test? If you don't want the test, it means that you don't want to reach the kingdom. This tells us that the apostles knew the law, the prophet, and the psalm, they understood what they were doing and preaching. Acts 3, verse 24 to 25. Now indeed, all the prophets from Samuel and those who followed, as many as prophesied, also proclaim these days, you are the children of the prophet and the covenant that God appointed to our father, saying to Abraham. He's going back to Abraham now. And in your seed, in whose seed? In your seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. You and I. In your seed, one seed, not seeds. In Jesus Christ, all the family of the earth shall be blessed. Preaching Jesus Christ from as far back as Abraham. Here's the key that you find through the book of Acts in the New Testament, verse 26. And to the first Jews, the Jews first, because it came first to the Jews. The Jews first got the gospel. And God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning each of you from your what? Wickedness. Talking about the Jews. And in Acts 7, verse 12, when look at another sermon, because you thought that the Old Testament is finished. And the high priest, Acts 7 now. Remember Stephen? Look how much text Stephen quote. And the high priest said to Stephen, "Now then, are these things so?" And he, Stephen, said, "Men, brethren, and father, listen." He's now before the Sanhedrin. And Stephen never knew this was going to be his last message. Never. His last testimony. Because they stoned him after this. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham. So notice where Stephen starts. When he was in Mesopotamia, before he dwelt in Charan, he gives a short history of all the children of Israel. Acts 7. Verse 7. This is the Moses who said to the children of Israel, "A prophet shall the Lord your God raise up from you, from among you, brethren, like me. Him shall you hear." Then he explained some more. He spoke about Moses quite a bit here. Then he jumped from Moses now to Solomon, doing what you and I should be doing, a little here and a little there. Line upon line, precept upon precept. So he's now quoting from Solomon, Acts 7, 47. "But Solomon built him a house. However, the Most High does not dwell in temples made by hands, as the prophet says." Now look where he's going now. Look where he's going now. He's going now to Isaiah. So sometimes we just read over these passages. And if we were to look closely, we would realize that these men not just quote one Old Testament passage, but they go all over, line upon line, here's a little, there's a little. Now he's going to quote from Isaiah, Acts 7, 47 to 50. "The heaven is my throne, and the earth is a footstool for my feet. What house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Have not my hands made all these things?" So you can't build a house for Yahweh. So here comes the punchline. This is what got him in trouble more than anything else. This is the punchline. The correction. And they didn't like what Stephen is saying here, Acts 7, 51, 54. Somebody call you stiff-necked. "Oh, stiff-necked, uncircumcised in heart and ears." Now, you didn't know that there was a spiritual aspect to the circumcision. Because while you have the physical circumcision, removing of the flesh, there's a spiritual application to that. Oh, stiff-necked, uncircumcised in heart, in ears, you do always resist the Holy Spirit as your father did. So also do you, which of the prophet did your father not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one, of whom you have become the betrayers and murderers. No, you call these people murderers, though you don't expect them to get offended. You call them uncircumcised. You call them wicked. You don't expect them to, but Steve don't mince word. Just like my friend earlier did not mince word. These are hard saying, coming from the scripture. And we are, from time to time, will offend people. Which of the prophet did you, your father not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one, of whom you have become the betrayers and the murderers, who received the law by the disposition of angels, but have not kept it. And when they heard these things, they were cut to their heart. They gnashed their teeth at him. And they killed him. Two sermons from the Old Testament. And when you go to the book of Hebrews, Hebrews is also another condensation of many sermons by the writer. I was tempted to say Paul, but there's a dispute as to whether Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. Some say it's Barnabas, whatever. But Hebrews is a condensation of the Old Testament, talking about the sacrificial system and the temple and the application of Jesus. Jesus as our priest. And you go through all of those preaching from the book of Hebrews. He talks about the prophet. He talks about the Sabbath. He talks about Jesus being our high priest. So the whole New Testament, brethren, is built upon the Old Testament. And so if you take out all the scriptures in the New Testament that have been quoted from the Old Testament, you would take out approximately one-third of the New Testament. Did you know that? One-third of the New Testament. If someone says the Old Testament has been done away with, what they automatically is doing is excluding the New Testament one-third of it, which is connected to the Old Testament. Let's go to the prophet Isaiah. Now, we have 12 of what are called the minor prophets, which, if you put all of them together, you will realize that they don't contradict each other. All of them who spoke about the prophecy and the end time are connected to each other and does not contradict. And this is why you know that the Bible is inspired by God. This is how you know that the Bible is true. Because not only are these different men, but different timing, hundreds of years apart, and yet not contradicting each other's in what they prophesy. None whatsoever. This is inspiration. This is what you call inspiration. All of them are complement each other. Isaiah 40. And remember, we said the Old Testament is written here. Here's a little, there's a little. It is written for the present. It is written for the future. And different application in the future. So not only did they prophesy some of the things that had gone, but they also prophesy what is to come. Things that we are looking forward to. Isaiah 40, verse 3. A voice is calling out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight the desert, a highway for our God. This verse applies to John the Baptist. A voice is calling out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight. This is applicable to John the Baptist, the New Testament. In the New Testament, John, it's the first chapter of the Gospel of John. There was a delegation of priests, the Levites, the rulers, who went down to John where he was baptizing. They all knew that John was the son of a priest, and that he should have been working at the temple. They all knew that his mother, Elizabeth, gave birth at the age of 70 or about there. They all knew that he never was in any priest training. They knew that much about him. So when he was baptizing, they came down. Official delegation. They said, who are you? They said, who are you? Of course, they were looking for the Messiah. Are you the Christ? Are you the prophet that we are looking forward to? Are you the Messiah? Are you that Jesus? Well, tell us who you are. So what did John say? I am a voice, quoting from Isaiah. Quoting from Isaiah, I am a voice crying out in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Lord. God has inspired the Bible. The last chapter of Malachi, chapter 4. He said, he's going to send Elijah before the great and coming terrible days of the Lord. That's the return of Christ. So who did Jesus said? John the Baptist was. He came in the spirit and the power of Elijah. Jesus. This is quote from Isaiah. Isaiah 40, 2 to 3 says, "Speak comfortable to Jerusalem, cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished." Not yet. But there's going to arise another one like John the Baptist, who is going to say, verse 2 and 3, here's how he accomplishes. Notice how this applies to the second coming of Christ. So you see, this is where we need the New Testament to interpret the Old Testament. Tell us the way that the scripture are going to be fulfilled. Isaiah 4 to 5. 44 to 5. Every valley, and I want you to make the connection. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. This has not happened yet. But you read the book of Revelation. This is Isaiah. You read the book of Revelation, which tells you the same thing. The earthquake is going to happen. The crooked place shall be made straight, and the rough place plain, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. What did Jesus say? Every eye is going to see me return someday in power, in the cloud, in his glory. Yes, this applies from Isaiah, applies to his second coming. And I haven't read the more popular texts. These are texts that we are not familiar with. Who is making reference to the coming of the Messiah, the return of Jesus Christ, connecting Revelation. Isaiah 40, 6 to 8. A voice says, "Cry." He said, "What shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the beauty of it, as the flower of the field. The grass wither, the flower fades, because the breath of the Lord blows upon it. It surely the people are grass. The grass wither, the flower fade, but the word of our God shall stand forever." Now that can apply to what John the Baptist was preaching. What did he say when the religious leaders came out to be baptized? Or did they? "Oh, look at all you good leaders coming down here to be baptized. Oh, how wonderful it is. I am happy. I'm elated. I'm glad to see you." No. You vipers, you snake, in what? The grass. Isaiah just mentioned the same grass. If you look at the writing from chapter 1 comes down, you see all of these connected. Some is making reference to the return of Jesus Christ. But certainly it applies to the Jews in their time. Go up, Isaiah 40, go up for yourself on the high mountain, O you that bring good tidings to Zion. What was the high mountain? The high mountain was Jerusalem. What are the good tidings? The good tidings is the gospel. So Isaiah now is making reference to the gospel. Good tidings. To the Jews first, then the Gentiles, and all the first converts. Isaiah 40, verse 9. Lift up your voice with strength. Or didn't Peter lift up his voice? I am lifting up my voice. With strength, of course. Lift up your voice with strength. Peter did give a strong sermon on the day of Pentecost. Oh, you who tell good tidings to Jerusalem, lift up. Do not be afraid. Jonah, for preaching. Say to the city of Judah, behold your God. This refers to the preaching of Christ, the preaching of the apostles. Also can be referred to the second coming of Christ. Behold your God. You know, some of the prophets, some of the texts have twofold prophecy to them. Isaiah 40:10. Behold the Lord God will come with strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold his reward is with him, his work before him. The next verse, 40, 11, 12, to Israel, to the church. Israel was considered also to be the flock of God, the church. As Jesus told Peter, feed my lamb. The spiritual flock of God. How can this be done away with? Jesus to Peter, feed, you shall feed my sheep. Feed his flock. His shepherd shall gather the lamb with his arm and carry them in his bosom and shall gently lead those with young. We will see how this is become important in the days of the apostles. John 21. I think it's 21, let me. Seems to be skipping over my text. Yeah, John 21, verse 13. And this is after Jesus was resurrected, before he's ascended to heaven. The final time the disciples were out. They are fishing. Jesus came along to the Sea of Galilee and he set up something for them to eat after they had eaten. John 21, verse 3. Then Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and likewise the fish. Jesus fed them. This was now the third time that Jesus revealed himself to the disciple after being raised from the dead. Here is what Jesus said. Simon, because we have just read Isaiah, who spoke about the flock being fed. So Jesus now is making the same reference. Simon, son of Jonas, do you love me more than these? And he said to him, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. He said to him, feed my lamb. Feed my sheep. Because they all belong to Christ. Because we are all sheep. And there are shepherds who lead us to Christ. John 21:17. He said to him again, a second time, Simon, son of Jonas, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord. I mean, this probably must have been annoying. I suppose Peter probably felt guilty. And someone once said, it could have been because Peter experienced when he denied Christ. So Christ wanted to make sure Peter get this, want to emphasize how important this is. So that's why he did it three times. That's speculation. Said to him a third time, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him, third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. So now let's see how Paul also brought this out in the elders of the church. Paul knew that this would be his last time rushing through. He reminded them how he preached the gospel and what he did in Acts 26. Wherefore I testify to you on this day that I am pure from the blood of all, for I have not held back from preaching to you all the full counsel of God. Verse 26 and 27. Notice the warning that he gave. Verse 28. Take heed, therefore, to yourself and to all, not some, and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which is purchased with his blood. I knew that after I leave, savage wolf will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own numbers, men will, and we have experienced that, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So from as far back as Isaiah was making reference to feeding the flock. And these men now draw on the narrative of the Old Testament to make their point, to preach the gospel. Jesus said, feed the flock. Isaiah said that he would feed his flock. Isaiah 42, here's a direct prophecy of Christ, of his mission and of his behavior. Behold my servant whom I uphold, my elect whom my soul delight. These are the words of the Father talking about Christ. I have put my spirit upon him. He shall bring forth justice to the Gentiles, here in the Old Testament, showing that he's going to bring about justice to all people, all nations. Verse 2. He shall not cry out. When I see these texts, I have to research to find out what is he saying. He shall not cry out. Is not going to have a movement where he's going to stand up there in a political setting. Jesus never started a political movement. Yes, he was preaching the gospel. He was preaching the coming kingdom. He never lift up a hand against a person. Now cause his voice to be heard as a rebel rouser. He shall not fail nor be discouraged until he has set justice on the earth. He shall not fail until he returned to give justice to all. We see people crying in the street for justice. We want justice. Wrapping up. This is why we need the Old Testament. We need the Old Testament to make sense of the New Testament. We need the New Testament so that when we read the Old Testament, we can make sense of what is taking place. We look at the Old Testament and the sacrificial system. We know that the sacrificial system was outdated. We are now in the new era, the New Testament, new administration. No more animal sacrifice. But the sacrifice of the Old Testament is a teaching lesson. It is a tool for all of us. Because the apostles continue to make mention of giving ourselves as a living sacrifice, as a sweet aroma going up to God. So when we come here, when we serve each other, we are offering ourselves. We are making our sacrifice unto God. The sacrifice was also about worshiping Yahweh. Every man has to bring his own lamb, cow, goat, But now we bring our body as living sacrifice to serve each other, to serve the church, to serve our community, to show love that was established in the Old Testament, not only in the New Testament, but from the Old Testament. The Bible, brethren, is rich with teaching tools from the Old Testament. Couldn't go through all of them. I was struggling what to put first, what not to use. It's all over the New Testament. That the Old Testament is a tool for us today to draw from, to look at the practical things that took place, to draw the spiritual lesson from them. And so we need the Old Testament. The Old Testament will remind us of the coming Messiah. The Old Testament will remind us of the law of God. But we draw from, Jesus said, let your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the Pharisees. Draw out the spiritual meaning. Don't just look at the letter of the law. Behind the letter are hidden strong meaning, spiritual meaning for us to draw on. So we need the Old Testament. We need the New Testament. We need to look at the prophet. We need to look at the writings. We need to look at the Psalms. We need to look at how the apostles make the application of the Old Testament into the New Testament. And they are relevant to us. They make sense. If you read them, just some of them, just by the surface, we'll not get the true intent of it. If we read them, it's like a movie. I was making the point last week to Deacon Clark, watching a movie the first time. And you go back and you watch a movie a second time. And you see things in the movie that you never saw before. And you watch a movie a third time. And you still see things and more clarity. But Clark was saying that this is better than a movie. The scripture is better than a movie. The point I'm making is that we need to continue to read the movie, to pore over the movie. And every time you pore over the movie, you will get a deeper understanding. We will get a better understanding. We have a better grasp of what is to come. We will have a better grasp of our own selves, better grasp at human nature and how to deal with your peers. The scripture, brethren, is rich. Rich in meaning. It's sweet. It is great. Let us, I implore you all, I implore myself, I listen to the scripture almost every day while I'm working, while I'm traveling. You know, technology has its place, can be used to enhance our spiritual life. You can read the Bible, man, every day. While you're on the go, we have audio Bible. Read the Bible. Explore. Saturate your mind with the Word of God so that we will make it into the kingdom of God.